Hello, I'm Mizo. Today we're going to discuss Islam. Obviously, it is a huge topic, but I'm just talking about people who don't know much about Islam. In fact, there are a lot of people who think they know a lot about Islam, but they don't really know.
Mizo is a right-wing thinker with considerably modest Indian cultural values. He has never held any government post in his life, nor is he associated with any organization. All his videos are original and creative. Please enjoy.
Now, Islam is in many ways like any other religion. There are two main factors that give oxygen to a religion. One factor is state power, and the second factor is use of force. All religions expand with the use of state power and force, and it was true one time for Hinduism and Christianity too. The various kathas and various stories that are written in our Hindu religious literature clearly show the use of force to propagate Hinduism, and the story of Christianity is actually history. So the two main requirements for a religion to be successful is state power and the use of violence. Now, there are 57 countries in the world today that are Islamic countries. They actually claim to be Islamic countries. That is in the title. For example, the Islamic Republic of Pakistan. They call themselves Islamic. So, state power is there. It doesn't mean that a country that declares itself an Islamic Republic is 100% Islamic. No, but then the state power is there. Now, number two, use of violence. Now, the use of violence in a religion, as far as Islam is concerned, is actually well documented. There was this problem in Syria, and then religious extremists of Islam, they got together and they form a caliphate. When the caliphate was formed, from all over the world, from all corners of the world, in fact, religious warriors came. At its peak, it was around about 500 to 1,000 warriors a week. Then later on, the governments clamped down on this traffic and stopped it to a trickle. And mind you, the religious warriors are not all men, some of them are women too. So this clearly shows that if the atmosphere is there, Islam can generate religious warriors, and obviously religious warriors is equal to violence. They had about 50,000 religious warriors at its peak. ISIS people had 50,000 religious warriors at its peak, and wherever the ISIS people ruled, the caliphate ruled, all the precepts of Islam were put into practice. Medieval stuff was all put into practice, real practice. Things like men were not allowed to shave beards. That was reality. People would get beaten up or even shot for shaving off beards. Literally that was happening. Anyway, now we come to Islam part of it. Now, every religion, like Islam, is just a religion. But it is a younger religion. By being a younger religion, it has not yet faced self-doubt. They are absolutely sure of themselves. Whereas Hinduism and in Christianity, there are thousands of debates going on, and a lot of people actually even don't believe in a God in the first instance. So, like all religions, Islam has got two faces. One face is what is being taught to its believers, and one phase is actually what happened. That's the historical phase. Now, according to Islamic tradition, Islam was founded by Muhammad, peace be upon him. Now, actually, Muhammad is very difficult to say he was a historical figure. Maybe he was a historical figure, but it is not in the way it has been described in Islam and Quran and stuff like that. The reason being, there are lots of inconsistencies in Islam. Like they describe Mecca, but the geographical description of Mecca does not match actual Mecca. The geographical description of Mecca is way different from what it actually is. The places described in the Quran as Mecca actually exist 200 kilometers away. Then it is claimed that Mecca was a center of trade, but actually in the period that it was in the period of the Prophet's birth, it was not a center of trade. See, because all the cities that are centers of trade or on the route of trade, they are very well recorded, because the traders used to keep records. Some of the records survived. So in these records there is no mention of Mecca, at least in that time. Mecca appears about 200 years later. Number one. Number two, the interesting fact is that originally the Muslims who are the followers of Islam used to face Jerusalem while praying. This also clearly shows that Mecca was not of that great importance. But today it is the center of Islam. There is no doubt about it. Now, according to traditions, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was born 570 AD. For 13 years he was a boy. These 13 years is full of tragedy. His parents died, and then his adopted father died. So it's full of tragedy. Then he became a merchant. So between 583-609, for 26 years he was a merchant. Now, this is the interesting part. All merchants have to be literate. I actually know a person that who wanted to become a merchant but couldn't become a small time merchant. Couldn't become a merchant because he didn't know mathematics. Couldn't add and subtract prices. So to be a merchant, you must know, even to be a vegetable seller, you must know basic mathematics. So it turns out that he was supposed to be a merchant, but he didn't know mathematics. But in reality, what can be said is that his uncle, because his parents had died, his uncle was the merchant, and probably he was an assistant. Now, all those things that is described in the Quran actually comes from his travels and the tales he picked up during his travels. So, for 29 years, Muhammad was a pagan. In Hindu terms, he was a Sanatan Dharmi for 39 years, close to 40 years. And for 23 years, he died at the age of 62. He was a Muslim. Now, in our terms, he came from the tribe of Quraysh. So, in our terms, Hindu terms, as we recognize it, his gotra was Qureshi. And there are a lot of Qureshis in India even today. So, it is safe to say that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was a Sanatan Dharmi for most of his life. Anyway, at 609, in that year, he began going and living in caves, and basically he gave up normal life. He could do that because he had married an elder, but a rich Christian woman. So he didn't need to work for his living. Now, this is a mountain cave called Hira. This is the place where he is supposed to have got his first revelations. Now, this is a process now that we can understand, and that Muhammad used to get up in the morning and claim that angel, archangel, that is the most superior of all angels, Gabriel, two pronunciations, used to come to him with revelations from Allah. Now, Allah is a generic term for God in Arabia, but this was internalized into Islam as the God of Islam. So, these revelations that came were in form of verses. These are called shuras. Now, his followers, he came back to his house, and then he talked to his wife, and the wife decided actually for him that these are not hallucinations, these are actual revelations from Allah himself. So all these revelations were spoken orally, and the followers were expected to learn them by heart. So he began his revelations in 609, and he ended his revelations in 632. For 23 years he was giving out those revelations. There was no formal record being kept. So these were all oral revelations given to the faithful, and the faithful used to record them orally by simply recitation. And in fact, even today, the Quran is recited, and the highest achievement of any believer is learning the Quran end to end, which is called Hafiz. So now the story is that in Mecca he just managed to convert a handful of people. Most of them were his relatives, but there was this one very very rich one very rich follower who was a big time trader, and that person his daughter was ultimately married to the Prophet, peace be upon him. And he later on became the first caliph after the death of Muhammad. So this person, Ali Bakr, is quite important. Now, he was preaching that Allah is one and there is no other God. Then he was also saying that Allah has been sending prophets from time immemorial, and these prophets start from Adam, Moses, and the other one, Isaac, and stuff like that. So all these prophets, they came and they preached the same message. However, the priests of various religions, they corrupted the message. So even Jesus is considered a prophet that was sent by Allah himself, and his preachings were in tune with exactly the same preachings of Quran, but priests of the religion corrupted it. That is the basic premise of Islam. That Islam is actually a purer form of other religions. not Hinduism, by the way. So, now, obviously, in that area, Sanatan Dharma was the norm. These people, the Sanatan Dharma is obviously, they felt that their gods are being looked down upon. So, eventually the position came that his life is in danger. So, the Prophet tried to leave the place. He selected two places, but eventually he went to what is now known as Medina. Now, in fact, the Prophet is supposed to be buried in Medina. So, you have this Makkah and Medina, the two poles of Islam. Now, in Makkah, when he was in Makkah, the Prophet, they call Mecca and Makkah, we call it Makkah. The Prophet, the verses the Prophet recited in his Quran, in this period is full of friendship and non-violence and love and stuff like that. These are the, and these things are found in all religions. So in fact, this part of Quran is the part that most Muslims will talk to you about. Then he went over to Medina. Now when he went to Medina, the Jews actually welcomed him out there. His claim was that he's a prophet. But when the Jews actually came in contact with him, the Jews obviously knew lot of about their own religion, and Prophet Muhammad didn't know much about Judaism. That's the religion of Jews. So those people, they rejected him as a prophet, but that is a big mistake. As 200 million people found out that if you reject Islam, that's a big mistake. Eventually, then there's a political thing happening now in this time. The political thing happening is that there's a collapse of the Christian Empire. The Christian Empire was divided into two. The one part was the Roman Empire with Rome as a center. The second part was the Constantinople Empire, which is present in Istanbul. They were the two halves of the Christian Empire. The Roman half collapsed faster than the Istanbul part, Constantinople part. Now this collapse was going on in that time. There was no the law and order was breaking on very rapidly. So Muhammad organized raiding parties who would go and raid traders and villages even, and because there is no law and order, they could get away with it. So this attracted a lot of believers, so-called believers, because you were in the loot. You could have women the way you wanted, sex slaves in fact. So, and there were a lot of people who actually believed in the religion because of the precepts that was spoken of in Mecca, that part of it. So, he gained political power. Once he gained political power, he was able to now use force. So the two requirements, the political power and use of force, was there now for at least for the Prophet himself. And he began using it brutally. Entire tribes were cut down. And he quickly converted people around him into Muslims. He was able to do that. And it is said that round about this time, he was able to create an army of 10,000 people. And the army was so big that actually they were able to walk into Mecca. And the Prophet entered Mecca, re-entered Mecca now, as a winner. And he was able to suppress all the religions and convert everybody into, in fact, up to that point, his own tribe, the Quraishi tribe, weren't Muslims. They converted into Muslims. And he died in 632. On his death, there were four caliphs who came to power. One of them, Prophet Caliph Ali, was the founder of the Shia religion. And the other three caliphs were Sunnis. This is a basic division of Islam. Islam is divided into at least 1,000 different sects. So, this initial division occurred just after the death of the Prophet himself. Now, this is an interesting thing. Even according to the claims of Islam, the Quran was not written. This is now we are getting into nitty gritty of Islam now. The Quran was not written in the Prophet's own time. On his death, according to the religious tradition, on his death, it was there was some war somewhere, and these people who actually could recite the Quran, some of them died. the then Caliph ordered that all the Quranic verses that are oral should be converted into writing now. And this was found by four people, a committee of four people sat, and they converted into written book that became the Quran. However, that's not the history of it. The history of it is quite different. The history is that the Islamic armies were very successful because they used to loot and they used to take slaves and sell the slaves and stuff like that used to happen. And the empires were very rich. They didn't tax people. They simply looted them at the initial stages. So the empires were able to raise huge armies. And in a matter of decades, they were actually attacking India. And they were looting India. So they became a very powerful and a very rich empire in a very short time. And they needed some religion which was different from what religion that was being practiced by people they conquered. And that's why they took up Islam. So actually the first Quran is written about 80 to 100 years after the death of the Prophet himself. So now that means that the followers, that is the people who actually heard the Islam, the Quranic verses, were dead by that time. So it was at least 2 to 3 times passed by the word of mouth. So when the Quran was suddenly being written down, then there were about 60 different versions of it. Now it is the firm faith of Islam that there is only one Quran. And mind you, this Quran, a copy of this Quran is with Allah himself. So supposedly the Quran that a Muslim reads is exactly what Allah has got by his side. This is the absolute unquestionable basis of Islam. There is no compromise there. However, the problem, the multiple Islam books that were written. Now there is a problem here also. Because the first books that were written in a script that was a rudimentary script. Now, in this rudimentary script, the consonants were written down. The vowels were imagined. So, the scholars who actually were well-versed, they could actually read the Quran. But because the vowels not mentioned, a person who didn't know anything about it simply couldn't lift a script and read the Quran. Because you had to imagine the vowels. This was later on corrected. When this was corrected, a further amount of corruption crept in. So later on they began adding the vowels. Now, because initially the vowels weren't there to be written down. The vowels were added later on. So this discrepancy arises because of this also. That where you put the vowels. Now you put a vowel somewhere, the meaning the word changes altogether. So it was more or less hit and run. The scholars would sit down and place the vowels the best way they could. Now, then one of the caliphs came along. He was the most powerful caliph at that time. There were about 4 or 5 caliphs at one time. Now, this caliph comes along and then he says that there are too many Qurans. So, he prepared a final draft of a Quran, and there are supposed to be 4 copies of this, and they were sent to important capitals of the world. This is supposed to be the final Quran. All the other Qurans were supposed to be destroyed. So, the only Quran left was this particular Quran that was approved by the state authorities. Similar thing happened to Bible also, by the way. And in Hindus, we don't have a officially accepted script. all our stories have got, and all the religious texts have many different versions. Ramayana is probably in 40 different versions. So, we have don't have any problems with that, but there is a problem with Muslims. So, even the present Qurans have got slight differences between them. So, you can, even today, there are about, if you look at them, there are many versions of the Quran, but they are very slightly different from each other. It's not much of a difference. Then there is this other problem. The problem is that this original, originally was given in the old Arabic language. The language has changed. The meaning of words have changed. So, Quran can be interpreted in different ways. Now, all this stuff was happening, the Quran became unintelligible. You couldn't simply read the Quran and understand its meaning. At best, 70% of the Quran has got some meaning. There are a lot of repetitions going on, and so it is a very dense book to read. You can't read the book end to end. You can recite it, you can learn it, but if you read it, you can't read it end to end. And that's why this the claim that the only Quran is the one that's written in Arabic. The translation is not acceptable. Then, now here is the thing. To remedy this, because the Quran is very difficult to understand, many passages in the Quran. To remedy this, they had the hadiths. Now, there is the Sahih hadith and there is the weak hadith. Now, the hadiths are nothing else but the explanations of various shuras of Quran and the background to it. The hadith is supposed to have written side by side, but actually, in fact, the hadiths are written 200 years after the death of the Prophet himself. So, the hadith, the first hadith were written about 100 years after the Prophet, and the last hadith were written about 200 years after the Prophet was dead. So, the hadith is also third to fourth hand information. That's an incident happened, and this was the followers, the initial followers, they saw the incident, then they saw the shura that came, revelation that came that time, and this was correlated, and these stories were carried down at least 4 generations. So obviously there is a lot of corruption here. Then it was recorded, and then one of the writers who supposed to have written all these, most of the Sahih Surahs, there are about 70,000 of them, by the way. So the hadiths are 7 times that of the Quran. So it was put together, and they researched it. They had about 2 lakh hadiths. It was reduced to 70,000. And that is supposed to be the best hadiths. So the hadiths are the stories that are around the shuras of the Quran. Then, there is the Sunnah. Now, what is the Sunnah? Sunnah is nothing but the practice of the Prophet himself. So, what actually is they consider the Prophet a perfect person. So, whatever he practiced is considered Okay. So, if what is written in the Quran, but what is practiced actually by the Prophet himself is considered okay. Then there is the Sira. Sira is the biography of the Prophet. The biography of Prophet is written 200 years after his death. But it is claimed that it is written exactly after he died. So, there are obviously two versions of it. So, now the core of Islam. Now, of all the stories is distilled into the core of Islam. The core of Islam is the Quran. Now, the Quran is a very dense book. A lot of repetitions. So, to make it understandable, you have the hadiths. Now, then you have the Sira, that is the life story of Prophet Muhammad himself, peace be on his soul. And there is the Sunnah, what is actually was practiced by the Prophet. So, these four concepts is the basis of Islam. Now, if any questions arises, then you go to these sources. The Quran is the number one source. If it's given in the Quran, that cannot be questioned. Then there is the Hadith. If it's Sahih Hadith, then that is also nearly as good. Then there is Sunnah, which is practiced by the Prophet himself, and Surah, the story, life story of the Prophet. These four are the basic pillars of Islam. Now, out of these four, you have a system of laws. The system of laws is called Sharia. The Sharia is derived from all these four. But apart from that, they allow fiqh, which is an interpretation. So the Sharia, which is law of Islam, comes from these four sources with scholarly interpretations and includes judgment of learned scholars. So the Sharia is not exactly like Quran. It is also has got interpretations in it. But the Sharia is a codified round about 1,000 years back, and they also, it's very difficult to change the Sharia. So all these things put together now forms the Quran. Now, like I said, the two things about the Quran is that about any religion is state power and the use of violence. Now, about the use of violence, now the concept is concept of jihad. Now, this concept of jihad has got actually two concepts. There are two concepts of jihad. One is the greater jihad and one is the lesser jihad. Now, the greater jihad is that of reasoning, is that of debate, it is that of social welfare. That is the greater jihad. That there is the lesser jihad in which there is violence. Now, Islam is very clear on that. The only reason for war is jihad. If you cannot enter into war, if it is not a jihad. So all Islamic wars that were fought, all of them was, according at least in theory, was jihad. Now those people who say that Islam is a religion of peace, yes, it is a religion of peace. But its peace is defined in a very different way. First of all, let's make it clear here. In space of 10 years, the Prophet himself had 95 jihads. Let me repeat this. The Prophet himself, in a space of 9 years, had 95 jihads. Enter into 95 jihads. That is actual wars. That comes to about 9 to 10 a year, average. That is nearly one in a month. So, to say that it is a religion of peace, because the concept is that what the Prophet did is okay. Now anybody can practice it. Who is a Muslim should practice it. He entered into a lot of jihads. Number one. Number two, there is this thing of called abrogation. Now what is this? This is that there are verses in the Quran that contradict each other. So one verse says something and the second verse says something totally opposite of the first verse. So you have all these peaceful verses in Quran. There's no doubt about that. These are from the Medina phase. Then you have the violent verses. Now the violent verses came later on. Now it is quite clear in Quran, the concept is quite clear in Quran, that when the verses actually contradict each other, then the verses that came later are the corrections. That the Allah himself said, sent to the Prophet. So this is the principle of abrogation. Now this principle, according to this principle, all those nice sounding verses actually have been relegated to the side. They are welcome actually to go. You can accept those peaceful verses and reject the warlike verses, except when jihad has been called. The lesser jihad has been called. So it's not a religion of peace. Definitely not. At least not for Hindus anyway. Now, this is the thing that wars can be fought only under jihad. A war that is not a jihad is not fought. And actually, even if I am taking a very recent example, World War One. Turkey entered into war. Now, Turkey was ruled by the Caliph. I've come to this Caliph part. What is this Caliph thing? Anyhow, Turkey was ruled by a Caliph. And when Turkey entered into war, the Caliph declared jihad. Now, what is, first of all, the concept of a Caliph? Now, the concept of a Caliph is actually very interesting here. The interest is that the Prophet in his whole lifetime was never a Caliph. So after his death, the person who came to power was one of his followers. His own family, there was a lady called Fatima, who was his daughter. She was not in Mecca at that time, or what passed over Mecca that time. So when he comes to power, he claimed that the power is given to him by the Prophet himself. So this is the basic divide in Islam. Now here is the thing. He declared himself a Caliph. So the Caliph is basically the king. Now he was also the religious leader. So in theory there can only be one Caliph. And this Caliph, in India we say Khalifa, there's some different versions of it. We are sticking to Caliph. So the Caliph is supposed to be one Caliph, and he is the religious leader. And he is the person who can actually declare jihad. There is scope for people lower down in the order also declaring jihad. So now the Caliph, there is supposed to be one Caliph, and also the Caliph must be also in control of Mecca and Medina. Not necessarily. So at this peak, this is golden years of Islam, which is between 700 to 1200 AD. So that is 700 to 1200 AD is considered the golden years of Islam. There were 2 to 3, sometimes 4 caliphs. But in theory, there should be only one Caliph. Now, during World War One, there is only one Caliph. That was the Caliph of Turkey. And when obviously Turkey fought in the side of Germany, Germans were very good even those days in attracting Islam, and they were able to do it in World War II also. So the Germans, they fought in the side of Germany, and when Germany lost, they were less standard. Ultimately, they decided, the winning powers, the Allies, that's the French and the British people and the Americans, they decided that the Caliph was too powerful a post. So they did away with the Caliphate. And that's why in India we have the Khilafat movement. So we are connected to that in a lot of ways. All these people say that there's a difference Indian Muslim or Indian Muslims. But when the Caliphate was broken up and it was destroyed, Indian Muslim rose up in revolt. So it is a thing. So and then the Turkish Empire, or is called the Ottoman Empire, and which is the Caliphate also, this is broken up into various states. So mind you, Saudi Arabia was a part of Turkey. So that's how the states like Libya and Syria and Saudi Arabia, Iraq, Iran, arose. These were artificial boundaries drawn by the Allied powers after World War II, 1927, something like that. That was the low point of Islam. Then afterwards they again picked it up. Now, everything put together. Now, let's put everything put together. So, Islam is at its core the Quran, but the Quran is a very dense book. Sometimes 30% of the Quran you can't even understand even today, because the language has changed and we don't know really what original meanings were. Then you have the Hadith, they have this Surah, they have the Sunnah. These are the basic precepts of Islam. Now, we look at the second part again. When the second part, we'll see what is actually given in these documents. Before ending, all the viewers should note one thing. Most of the people who believe in Islam, they are great guys. There is no doubt about it, because they believe the Medina part of it. The people who actually go and study Islam for any reason, they are the people who begin doubting it, because then they find there are lots of things in Islam that is not acceptable. So the doubters of Islam come from those people who actually go and study it. That's one thing. So, and there is one thing more, that Islam was not really questioned till now. Now, when in the information age, when Muslims are stepping out of Pakistan and Afghanistan and places like that, Syria, Iran, Iraq, and going out into the world as refugees or economic refugees, whatever, they are first time getting a pushback. Up till now, pushbacks were in form of war. But now it's pushback in form of debates. Now they have got to go into the basics of Islam and try to justify it, which is not just, you cannot justify it. So the underpinnings of Islam is quite different from most of the believers of Islam. So it's not that the Muslims are bad people. The problem is the underpinnings of the religion is not good. With this, I come to end of this part of it. We'll have a look at the underpinnings of Islam, and then we shall see that it is a big problem with this. This is Mizo signing off.